Good morning. So today I'm going to deal with the third section of the Westland, and this is the fire sermon. Now try to have a look at the title of this section, that is the fire sermon. Now you'll find that it originates from the fire sermon of Lord Buddha, where the world is shown burning with different evils like lust, hatred, corruption, and sexual perversion. And it also brings to mind one of the confessions of Saint Augustine, in which, the saint represents lust as a burning cauldron. So these are the very two sources of this section, that is the fire sermon. Fine. Now this fire sermon of Lord Buddha, it refers to the east, and the confession of Saint Augustine, it refers to the west. So the meaning is that the evil of lust has gripped both the east and the west. So the section is a sermon, but it is a sermon by examples only. Why? Because it depicts the evil of lust through different sex experiences of the modern wastelanders. So when you talk about a sermon, a sermon is something where you can find moral preaching and moral teachings. But in the section, you'll find different sex experiences of different people. And that's why I'm saying that, it is a sermon. I mean, though the section is a sermon, but it is a sermon by examples only. Otherwise, you will find evil and lust everywhere, particularly lust in different forms. Fine. Now, if you go through the text of the section, you will find that it opens with Tiresias. He may be the protagonist and he is the commentator. And he's a link between the past and the present. Fine. So the section opens with Tiresias, and he surveys the bank of the Thames River. Right. Now the text shows that the tent formed over the Thames by the trees, it has now broken due to the arrival of the autumn. So we have the picture of the banks of the Thames River, and on both the sides of the banks, we find some trees, and the trees have formed a kind of tent. So now with the arrival of the autumn, this tent, which has been formed by the trees, it has been broken. Fine. And even the last few leaves of the trees, they are falling gradually on the wet banks of the river. Fine. And at the same time, the lost lovers who had crowded the banks during the spring, now they are no longer there. It means they all have departed. So during the summer, these people came to the banks of this Thames River. They enjoyed here. But after the spring is over, they have also departed. Fine. Now before their departure, they have polluted the river banks with cigarette ends, sandwich papers, empty bottles and card boxes. These are the very things of enjoyment and merriment. So when they came over here, they brought with them cigarette ends, sandwich papers, empty bottles and card boxes, right? And before their departure, they have left all the things here, and in this way you just can say that they have polluted the river bank with such things. Fine. So here the poet presents a dichotomy between the past and the present. How? He presents it by showing how the river, how the bank of this river, I mean the Thames River, how it was used in the past and how it is being used in the present. Getting my point? So he's trying to present a dichotomy between the past and the present by showing how this bank river, this bank of the river, I mean how it was used during the past time and how it is being used at the present time, particularly by the modern wastelanders. Fine. Now the poet refers to Prothalamion by, Spencer. I hope you remember that Prothalamion and Epithalamion, these are the wedding songs written by Spencer. And the song that I am referring to here, this is Prothalamion. And, it is a song honoring the marriage of Elizabeth and Catherine Somerset. And it has been written by, Spencer. Fine. So in this song, in Prothalamion, the bank of the Thames River, it was used for the marriage purpose of Elizabeth and Catherine Somerset. But now, the same bank is used by different lovers. And who are the lovers? They are the loitering and aimless sons of city directors. And, they use the bank for their sexual pleasure. Getting my point? So they use the bank of the Thames for beastly copulation and not for marriage purpose. So in the past, this bank of the Thames River or the banks of the Thames River, they were used for some pious purposes like marriage. But at the present time, they are used just for beastly, copulation, not for marriage purpose. Fine. Then the river in the past, it was clean and pure, but now it has been polluted and it sweats oil and tar. Fine. Now this pollution of the river, it symbolizes spiritual degeneration. And the water is a source of purification and regeneration. But people in the modern society, they do not realize this fact. And that's why they do not hesitate to pollute it. They do not hesitate to pollute the water of the river. Right. Then try to have a look at the text and you'll find that, you'll find the protagonist, and this protagonist is lamenting the pollution of river, and he's sitting on its bank, on the bank of the Thames River. Then suddenly he hears the cold wind, and this cold wind is blowing, and it reminds him of the senseless laughter of the London crowds, who are moving about or who move about rattling like dried bones. Getting my point? So now we find the protagonist, and that is Tiresias, and he's lamenting the pollution of the river, and he's sitting on its bank. Fine. And he hears the cold wind blowing, and it reminds him of the senseless laughter of, the London crowds who move about rattling like dried bones. So this crowd can be compared to the crowd of the first section moving over, the London Bridge. And we found that those people moving over, the London Bridge, they were spiritually dead. Fine, though they were living physically, but spiritually they were dead. Fine. Then the poet depicts the squalor and sordidness of the modern society through a rat. And this rat is creeping through the vegetation, and this rat is dragging its slimy belly on the bank. Fine. Then he depicts the naked bodies and bones cast in a low, dry garret. Fine. And such images, they are very horrific images. So we can say that it symbolizes decay and decomposition, as they are horrifying images signifying rootlessness, spiritual dryness, and sordidness of the modern society. Fine. And again, the story of Philomela is referred to. Why? Once again, the poet is trying to present a dichotomy between the past and the present. And he's trying to say that in the past, transformation was possible, regeneration was possible. Why? Because people repented and they suffered. And that's why transformation was possible. It could be possible in the case of Philomela. But in the modern society, this transformation is not possible because we do not believe in suffering and we do not repent. Fine. Then the poet further proceeds to link the wasteland symbol to that of Shakespearean tempest. And he does it by quoting a line spoken by Ferdinand. Ferdinand is the prince of Naples in the tempest. I'm just quoting the line that is spoken by, Ferdinand in the play. And this is, I quote, "Sitting upon a bank, weeping again the king, my father's wreck." Right. Then we find more degradation in the irony contrast between Dinah and Mrs. Porter and her daughter. And, they wash their feet in soda water, not for spiritual purification or regeneration, but to make their flesh look fairer to attract males. Fine. So again, there is a kind of irony contrast between Dinah and Mrs. Porter and her daughter, right? Then hotels like Cannon Street and Metropole, they have been portrayed as hotbeds of corruption and homosexual activities. And, Tiresias is also invited to, these hotels, which are the hotbeds of corruption and homosexual activities. Fine. Then the poet takes us to the lower class. And here, we come across a typist in her office. And, she's working in the office, but, she's waiting for the office to be closed. And that's why she's looking towards the clock recurrently. Fine. So she's compared to a human engine waiting and throbbing like a taxi. Why? Because she's willing to leave the office. Fine. Anyways, she's back to home. And suddenly her lover arrives and, they commit sexual activity. So once again, there is no bond between this typist and her lover. There is no exchange of words between the two. There is no emotional bond between the two. And they commit sex like automatons, right? So we can say that more irony contrasts are presented through the typist and the lovely woman in The Vicar of Wakefield. The Vicar of Wakefield, it's a novel written by Oliver Goldsmith. So how there is a contrast, or how there are irony contrasts between this typist and the lovely woman in The Vicar of Wakefield. The typist, even after committing the adultery, she is not ashamed of her fallen action, right? And she seems to be concerned for her face and hair rather than the loss of chastity. Getting my point? After the sexual act is over and her lover has departed, then she goes in front of the mirror. And there she's trying to have a look at her face, and she's trying to see whether everything is fine on her face. Her powder is fine, her puff is fine, her hair is fine. So the thing is that even after committing the adultery, she's not ashamed of her fallen action. Rather, she seems to be concerned for her face and hair and puff and powder rather than the loss of chastity. But on the other hand, the lovely woman in The Vicar of Wakefield, she commits suicide when she is betrayed by her lover because she feels herself to be guilty. fine. So that is the difference between this lady and the lady of the vicar of Wakefield, right? So we can say that even the relationship between men and women in the modern wasteland, it has become barren. And the incident between the typist and her lover, it is a picture of degraded love. It is a picture of fallen love, love without emotions and feelings. Right? Then this degradation reaches its zenith with the description of the three Thames daughters. And if you go through the text, you'll find that the three Thames daughters are molested cruelly on different places. Fine. And the molestation of the first Thames daughter, I think this is sufficient enough to show beastly copulation in the modern wasteland. So let us try to have a look at the plightful situation of the three Thames daughters. I'm talking about the first one. So when the first Thames daughter is raped, she says, I'm just quoting, two lines from the text. She says, by Richmond, I raised my knees, supine on the floor of a narrow canyon. So she says that, by Richmond. Richmond is a picnic spot, and that is near the Thames River. So she says that in Richmond, she was forced to raise her knees and she was forced to lay, on the flat body on the surface of or on the floor of a narrow boat. And there she was raped very brutally. Right? And this agony reaches its climax when we come to know, about the rape of the third Thames daughter. So I'm again quoting some lines from this section. And she says, on Margaret Sands, I can connect nothing with nothing. The broken fingernails of dirty hands, my humble people who expect nothing. So Margaret Sands, again, this is a picnic spot, and she was raped on this picnic spot. And she was raped so heavily that, after the rape, she became somehow unconscious and she could connect nothing with nothing. Means she was not able to realize anything after this rape. And then she says that, she is a poor woman and her people are poor people and they are like broken fingernails of dirty hands. And they are humble people and they expect nothing. Right? So, the two examples, I mean that of the first Thames daughter and the third Thames daughter. So the two examples show women exploitation in the modern society. Right? So we have developed scientifically and technologically, but still we are not ready to give proper respect to our women. Still, we feel them to be objects and commodity just to use for the sake of gaining pleasure. Right? Now this sex incident of the three Thames daughters, it can be compared to Elizabeth's relationship with her favorite Leicester, Queen Elizabeth. She had, words go that she had very close relationship with this man. Right? But there is a difference between the relationship of Elizabeth with her lover and the relationship or the relationships in the modern society. See, in her relationship, the queen was dominant, right? But today, the woman is a sufferer. As we have seen, the three Thames daughters, they are the sufferers. Fine. So today, woman is the sufferer. I mean, she has been exploited, and she has been exploited in different ways. Getting my point? Then, the section ends with the lines of both Augustine, Saint Augustine, and Lord Buddha, right? So I'm reading the last lines of the section, and the last lines are very crucial. So the last lines are like, to Carthage then I came, burning, burning, burning. O Lord, thou pluckest me out. O Lord, thou pluckest burning. So Carthage is a city which was founded by the Phoenicians in the 9th century BC. And, you know, it was destroyed and rebuilt by the Romans. Right? So the section ends with the lines of Augustine and Lord Buddha. And the section states, to Carthage then I came, burning, burning, burning. The entire world is burning, you know, in the evils of, or with the evils of lust and fire and hatred and sexual perversion. O Lord, thou pluckest me. So this is the request of Saint Augustine and Lord Buddha to God. What they are saying? They are requesting the God to pluck them out of this burning cauldron, out of this evil land, that is the wasteland. Right? So, you know, this is the request of Lord Buddha and Saint Augustine. Fine. Now the entire section shows that sexual perversion and lustful activities, you know, they are the very cause of spiritual death in the modern society. Fine. And it is all pervasive. I mean, this sexual perversion, it is all pervasive. Means it is in all the societies, it is in all the sections of the societies, and regeneration is possible only if, you know, we follow the teachings and preaching of Lord Buddha and Saint Augustine. Fine. So there is a possibility of regeneration and salvation, and the possibility is, you know, the possibility is only when you go to the shelter of the Almighty. So regeneration is possible only if you follow the teachings and preaching of Lord Buddha and Saint Augustine. So this is enough about the section. So thank you very much and good day.